associate German cuisine with fat meats for real men. Fans of it won't be disappointed in Cologne. Menus with fries, or in German, Fritten, can be found on every corner. Same goes for some of the domestic dishes, like Flunch, a blood sausage, or Hämmchen, a bone serving of pork with sauerkraut and mashed potatoes.
Masses, everybody.
I feel like I just dropped the mic and go.
Your job is done.
My job is done, I guess. Thank you very much for everyone turning out here today. I know there's a couple of you already been here for the past couple of days, so thanks for joining us in the last day of the ESL Studios. Now it's time to start talking about what we have upcoming. Let's take a quick look at the bracket, though, before we do that, though. As we've already completed game number one, if you're just tuning in, we have four best of five today. One of them has already been completed. Sue, as many people expected, won 3-0 over Lambo and has made it to the semi-finals, where he plays at Gamescom and, more importantly, plays for a chance at the World Championship if he gets top two and plays for the chance to be an Intel Extreme Masters champion. Up next is Fantasy versus Patience. Two teammates go head-to-head now in a best of five that they didn't play that long ago either. They played a couple of weeks back, Moonglade.
Yes, they did. They actually played in a DreamHack Valencia when Patience took that one 3-2. Very close match, all mind games. We actually heard Fantasy talk about that the other day, or it might have been Patience, one of them, saying it was just pure mind games. He prepared a lot better that day. So it's going to be interesting to coming into today and they get that rematch again, because these players, they don't seem too close for teammates because they are mind gaming each other. They have a lot of preparation against each other. So it actually is pretty interesting.
Throughout the weekend, or throughout the week, should I say, in the tournament, both players, whenever they've played against a different opponent, they've had each other come up to each other and talk about strategy and, hey, I watch your game, you should continue on. They've been really supporting each other at this tournament. And Fantasy did mention yesterday, if I could play one person, I don't want it to be you in the quarterfinals. And he got that unlucky draw. But talk to us a little bit about the aspect of mind games and messing around with each other, especially when your teammates like this. Why was the last series like that, and why this one could possibly be as well?
It's so weird. You kind of think of it as playing yourself sometimes when you're playing a teammate. You're like, well, what would I do if I was to play myself, if I was in their shoes? Because they know so many of your secrets. They're the people you often watch games with together, whether you're in a team house or just online together, and you're kind of talking about whether it's Pro League, GSL, and you're sharing all your thoughts on the matchup. And then you start to sometimes, if you're not as experienced, you get in your own head. Now, these guys have been up here before. They've been on these stages. So what they've probably been thinking about is the small tells and the reads and the reactions their opponent's making. So what you want to be doing is thinking about, how can I give off that fake information? How can I make them react in a way? And then how can I take it one step further and take advantage of their reaction? So this is where it gets kind of convoluted, right?
Yeah.
For watching, sometimes it's very hard to identify this exactly where those mind games are happening.
Show one thing, do the other type of games, and I'm sure that's probably what we're going to be looking at. But let's talk a little bit about Fantasy. It's his second Intel Extreme Masters tournament playing here in Cologne. He played in the World Championship a little bit earlier on this year for Season 9. He was a qualifier, came through the European qualifier to make it. He played in there, played in the round of 16, won a game 3-0 against Rain, then went into the quarterfinals where he was eliminated against the finalist Trap. But Fantasy seems to be playing some of the best StarCraft 2 that we've seen, or definitely at least the results aspect of it.
Yeah, this year he's been playing fantastically, better than he ever has, and he just keeps getting better and better. He has a lot of ups and downs and surprise losses. I think Patience is probably the one that's actually shot him in the foot, surprisingly, I guess. You wouldn't really expect someone like Patience to do that, considering who Fantasy's beaten in the past, but it just all comes back to being teammates and sharing everything together. It can really come back to bite you in StarCraft.
Do you think that because maybe Fantasy feels like he has been playing on a bit of a higher tier, that he's maybe going to be trying to take that safer approach and maybe be looking to try to stop the mind games, get things into a more solid late game? Do you think he's going to be playing more like that?
I think he probably should, because if you consider how he lost in DreamHack, it was a lot of aggressive play, a lot of mind games, and kind of all-ins from Patience that caught him out. If you can take a step back from that, play a safer, solider game, you don't want to change your style too much, even if they are a teammate, because that could just throw yourself off in general.
What would you say Fantasy's biggest strength is, though, when you look at him as a StarCraft player?
He's just pretty well-rounded in general. I couldn't really pick out anything. He's not like an overly aggressive Terran player. He's a Kespa. He came from Brood War. He's got the mechanics ingrained into his soul right now, so he can just perform like every high-level Terran Korean player we do see come from that sort of background.
He's got some tenacity as well. You know, we know that Fantasy GG timing once in a while does bring him back, but he's very steely, right? You don't see him get tilted because he's just in there micering his last units. He just tries to the last moment. So I think he's got that mental fortitude going from his experience as well.
Yeah, I completely agree with that.
Well, let's switch your focus then to Patience, who is a player that's one of the most friendliest StarCraft players you could ever meet. I'm sure if any of you guys here get a chance to take a photo with him, he's going to be very, very polite and very nice to you. He's that type of guy. But in StarCraft, he's a mean son of a... you know where I'm going with that one, because he plays Protoss, first of all. Yep. Let's just go down that angle. And he's not afraid to pull out some of the dirtiest type of strategies.
He certainly is one of the most aggressive Protosses we have these days. He is one of those dirty Protoss players that will all in every game they can, and just complete aggression all the time. Shameless.
Shameless
Apollo.
You can tell when a Zerg player's had to deal with that, the way they start to speak about that sort of play style. But Patience is a guy who's always been very aggressive. I actually remember when he was going under the ID, I think it was Lucy Prime back in the day.
Right.
And I actually lived with him for a while when I was over there in Korea. And from the very start, he was always looking for those very fine-tuned, aggressive strategies. And since then, he's developed so much as a player. He came over to Europe last year and had a lot of success in tournaments. And this year, he's been still getting these opportunities abroad, but hasn't been doing quite so well in those Korean leagues.
Yeah, I think that a lot of people, when looking at Patience, especially because he was living in Europe last year, he was the type of player where you'd categorize him as, okay, if you go back to Korea, goodbye, that's the rest of your StarCraft career over with. Mm-hmm. But he's managed to stay afloat in the Korean scene, which I think is probably one of the most impressive things about Patience, is he's still hitting and qualifying for the big leagues.
He still has the potential to go, you know, at least to get into these leagues. He hasn't really made it too deep just yet, but he has potential for sure. He's a great player, and maybe a little too predictable with his current style, the way he is so aggressive, but there is always potential there for him. He actually is one of those few Koreans that came back to Korea and performed.
So if you were to summarize this matchup real fast for us before we jump into it, is it as we said, a game of mind games here? Is it a game of, you know, Patience being aggressive towards Fantasy? How would you just kind of summarize it a little bit?
It's going to be close for sure, and I think it's going to be about Fantasy. Has he figured out what he did wrong the first time around? Can he defend against what Patience is going to throw at him? Because I'm sure it's going to be a very aggressive style from him as well.
I've got to agree with Glade, but if Patience has been anticipating this match, I'm thinking that at least one game he's going to go out and show some extreme greed and kind of throw that curveball by doing the unexpected.
All right, thank you very much, gentlemen. It's time to head to the commentary team for this one. Which teammate goes through to play in Championship someday? Goes through to play at Gamescom on the main Intel Extreme Masters stage? Let's find out with Todd from Rotterdam.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. And since I have been dropping some knowledge bombs around the city of Cologne, did you guys know that when Fantasy and True played against each other just a couple weeks ago, this man was casting and wearing the same shirt as he's wearing today.
Fantasy and True played a couple of weeks ago?
Fantasy and Patience.
So much for the knowledge bombs, Gabe. That you butchered that joke.
I kind of, well, it wasn't really a joke. It was more like an observation. I just put up these VODs. I was like, it's my friend Letod. He casted the series. And he's like, he's wearing the same shirt.
Yeah, listen. When you go to Valencia, it's very warm there.
I know.
I'm known not to really like when it's very warm. So, short sleeves here. If you must know, the AC is not working very well. So, short sleeves again. Didn't even ask for permission. Just went for it. YOLO.
We're getting ready to hop into this series, the second quarterfinal of the day, and I think it's going to be an awesome one, Todd. Watched a little bit of those games they played against each other last time, and like Moonglade said as well, the analysis desk, those games, they were very close. They were very wild, back and forth. I like the approach that Fantasy had. Of course, whenever you go up against a teammate, there's always a lot of mind games involved. But I like the variety that he showed in his openings. A lot of Terrans will go Reaper into CC on the low ground, followed up with a mind drop 5 games in a row. And I think it's a super solid build. But don't do it 5 times in a row, because it just becomes too predictable. You're going to give the Protoss too many options to cut a corner here and there. As we are pretty much good to go, I believe. Right, Todd?
Yeah. It's going to be good. Look at his Fantasy. He's actually He's got the 5-year celebration portrait there on BNet. What a boss. All right. Playing a bit of Pac-Man earlier on an arcade.
The first map is going to be played on Coda, I believe, in this best of five. Not exactly sure what the map leaders are, but we'll figure it out as soon as we get into another game. I asked Patience before the series, like, what are you going to veto? And he's like, actually, I don't know yet. He's like, maybe Coda, but it seems like he changed his mind thought as we are looking at this base of our blue proto spawning on the left-top side of Coda, representing that pixels. It is Patience. One of the most cheeky guys in the industry. But like Apollo said as well, he is. But like Sean said, as soon as he goes in game, he's not all that cheeky anymore.
And his opponent, staying on the right-hand side, lost just 2-3 last time these two met. It is Fantasy. To me, Fantasy versus Patience is, I feel, a series and a match about a very solid Terran that's very good in late game, and I would say most of the time rather cheesy proto. So the last time they were going up against each other, I really felt like Fantasy, he shouldn't give Patience any benefit of the doubt. He should just scout a lot, see what he's up against, and counter it, and then win. But he didn't do that. On Cactus Valley, he went for a command center first, a late scout, he died to a proxy's target. So I feel like in this series, Fantasy is going to have to correct what he did wrong last time, and that's, I guess, not scouting enough. I feel like he needs to scout enough. He really needs to prepare for anything that could be thrown his way. And if he's able to take it, you know, to that third base situation, have a lot of medivacs and bio, then I don't think he's going to lose all that often against somebody like Patience. And yeah, the one game, actually, the first game in their previous series, it was like that.
I like where you were going with it. Patience can be indeed a little bit of a cheesy Protoss. I've always felt he's similar to the Protosses like Stardust, for instance. You know, they can be cheesy, but they're also very unpredictable. They're very hard to figure out. But I do feel that overall, Patience is a little more well-rounded. And especially when it comes to PvT, probably has a stronger late game than someone like Stardust. So it should be an interesting series. Fantasy, like you said, will most likely just making sure that he doesn't die early, that he doesn't take too much damage. This is an interesting opening already by Fantasy, as he got the refinery, but it wasn't really a gas first or something. It's just a marine into. This is kind of an interesting opening thought, because I don't think he has a Reaper, right?
Yeah, he doesn't. This might just be the old MVP build, you know, where you get the reactor and then you throw down the command center and then you get the factory a little bit later. So you have more minerals than if you took that gas very quickly. I think Patience, there is one build he never does here, and that's the safe Protoss versus Terran rain build where you drop down the Robo, you get three Stalkers, and then you take into Colossus and Blink. He never ever does that. He's either Blink or DTs or Stargate, sometimes with an offensive Oracle, sometimes with defensive Phoenixes. If you pick up on that, I think as a Terran you can really play a lot more defensive and sometimes even try to throw in, you know, a quick third command center, and by that I mean not after one barracks, but after three barracks.
Do you think he's opening like this because he's afraid of that Oracle play from Patience, so he will have a few more Marines to work with? Because of course the Reaper slows down your Marine production.
I think he just wanted to go for something there, like safe, a quick expansion, but didn't go for a Reaper because he wanted to get a little bit more of an economy going into it. And I guess since he's going to get the factory behind this, he's going to be fairly safe against pretty much anything, assuming, you know, he gets some Widow Mines and some Medivac. So it's a better economy. It's less aggressive than some of, you know, the very quick gas that you can do. And I kind of like it because, just like I was saying, I really feel like if you're Fantasy here and you play it a little bit more passive than usual, make sure that you reach that third base situation. I do think he's going to be doing a lot better than the last time that they played, and he got all in the died, obviously.
Patience, of course, the last Protoss remaining in his Intel Extreme Masters cologne. That was very different just a couple weeks ago in Shenzhen, where it was one big Protoss party. As we see, of course, we had a slightly different lineup in that tournament as well. We'll see if he can keep the Protoss pride alive. I was spying on Fancy a little bit earlier to see how he was warming up. Thought he was playing Pac-Man.
What a boss.
Today we learned that playing Terran is basically like playing Pac-Man.
He was actually pretty bad at Pac-Man, no joke. Like, no. He lost in level 1 twice.
I saw him complete the level though. I was like trying to show him the
After the third time, man. Are you kidding me?
It was really funny.
It's a Korean pro gamer we're talking about.
I was like, hey, Fancy, look at this. I took a picture. And he's like not looking at all. He's like trying to complete this level. He looks at me. He's like, just get lost, man. Then in the end, he's like, oh yeah, funny. I don't think he appreciated the Terran joke. Either way, it's going to be a couple Hellions. This is a cool opening as well, though. This is super old school if he also decides to bring out the Marines. TLO was one of the very first Terrans ever that I saw doing this build. And I'll never forget it, because it was the Homestory Cup 2, and I think he did it against Whiterun Scrap Station. You know, he dropped a bunch of Marines in the main base, and he cruised by with a bunch of Hellions in the natural, and I was like, wow, that's actually a really cool build. Yeah. Well done, TLO. This can be very, very hard to deal with if your units are out of position as a Protoss.
Yeah, if you're not prepared, then or even if a few units out of position, you can take a lot of damage. But I do think, yeah, I'm even seeing this with the Observer here, it's such a huge info here for Patience.
He's going to find the Hellions as well. If I was Patience right now, I would probably evacuate my natural. Yeah, there you go. I think that's a smart call, Todd, because it's going to be extremely difficult not to take economic damage against Hellions and these Marines. You have to Photon Overcharge somewhere. That Sentry is very exposed. The Sentry is going to almost get picked up immediately, but
they're still
going to
get a few probes. Look at this, get into the natural already. Five have gone down.
More than just a few, because he didn't evacuate all of them. He only evacuated a bunch. He has ended up losing seven
warriors. Oh, the minivac? What? What is going on? Why did Fantasy go back into the Stalkers and Photon Overcharge? That was so weird.
Because he wanted to drive him in the main base with the Hellions. He wanted to go for everything, Todd. He wasn't happy with the seven kills. He wanted to get 17.
It's funny, I was about to compliment him for pulling back on time, and then this happened. And not a medivac. He's actually sending up very quickly here to drop some Widow Mines in the main, but Patience has a cannon there already. And he's going to have another Photon Overcharge here in a second. He has enough Stalkers in the natural to, I think, defend properly.
If he lines them up to make sure that the Hellions can get in, then yes. But if the Hellions get by these Stalkers, they will still kill 5, 6, 7 workers over there.
Maybe more, actually.
Here comes that mine drop. Cannons won't have enough DPS, but Photon Overcharge will. Make sure you focus the mines. One mine will probably shoot. Yeah, got 3 workers. That's not even all that bad. And the Stalkers went out to usher these Hellions away. Still though, cool opening by Fantasy, and I definitely think it went okay-ish. I mean, he's going up to 3 bases, he's up 1 worker. Not all that bad.
Yeah, that's actually a fairly quick 3rd base there, before he had it on the racks 4 and 5. So I quite like it. I mentioned this earlier, you know, I think he can go for a quicker 3rd base, but not that quick, because then he would be exposed to a lot of Hellions on 2 bases. And now remember, Patience is a very, very aggressive Protoss. Now, he started falling behind. He's already lost 10 probes in total this game. Does that encourage him, you think, a little bit more to maybe try for a 2 base there?
It can be difficult as well, though, when you take that much economic damage. And he also opened up with 4 observers that Funka was showing us. 5 even, man. He's going full pig baby over here. He's shelling his inner pig baby. Open up with 5 observers. Yeah. Still took quite a bit of economic damage, and of course during all this Fantasy is going up to 3 bases. Yeah, I think you're right, Todd, because I think if I'm Fantasy right now, well,
The last time that these two played on this map, Patience opened with DTs, and Fantasy, he also lost to Lilbo doing DTs on this map. So I think his build order, actually thinking back on it, was pretty, I think, pretty okay against DTs. You get 2 command center pretty quickly with the unorbital command, and then you drop the eBay at the ramp. Those Hellions so far, not doing that much.
No, come on. 5 workers again, Todd? I think that's pretty damn solid. 6 workers and all these probes without mining. Fantasy has created a 14...
Oh, the misclick.
Oh my god. 14 worker lead for himself. So far, I feel this game has been all Fantasy. If you're only defending, Todd, if you never have any sort of aggressive map presence, if you never have the option to do anything, it's going to be very hard in general to win a Protoss versus Terran. You know, Patience really needs to start taking some initiative. He needs to make something happen soon.
I'm actually really surprised he went for the 3rd base there. I fully expected him to, you know, go for a lag gateway explosion and kind of go for an attack, but instead,
I actually think he's going to be able to cancel it, because most of these Protoss units are out of position. Yeah. These Marauders do have Stim. Marauders will take care of this Nexus. Patience
he wants to recall, but this Nexus is not finished.
This Nexus is going to go down. 3 Marauders is enough to cancel this Nexus, and this may trigger Patience to really go for a super big all-in, because what else are you going to do? If he plays this out in a macro game, being down a base, being down 13 workers, it's not going to be pretty.
Fantasy even scanned to kill an Observer there back at home, and he got it quite easily. I feel like this is another Fantasy we're seeing, but the one that played against Patience last time at DreamHack, because he's dominating hard here. And he's going to have so much map presence, he can just stay out on the map, make sure that any time Patience leaves his base, there is a counter drop ready, a big doom drop or something like that. These observers, though.
Oh my god, look at the supply, Todd. I didn't even really pay attention to that. 89 against 135. This has been a massacre.
Oh, Patience. He had a cheeky probe down there. Yeah, he's going to get some of these units there.
This could be the start of the comeback. Maybe he's going to get a second one, too. These medevacs will try to unload as quick as possible. There's a Widowmine in the mix as well. Probably want to pick up and just get the hell out of there.
Oh, there's one burrowed there. The Stalkers are going to blink forward. Oh, they actually dodge it. without even knowing.
That was very good for Patience, and he needs to do something like that like two more times. And then we have an even game. Because
it's fantasy. Oh, my God.
Well, here we go. Maybe this is number one. If he gets one more full medevac.
Fantasy is setting up to drop on the right-hand side the other right now, and that War Prism will actually spot that.
Like two passing ships in the night, though.
God, please no.
Two passing ships that don't really like each other. Are you sailing in my water, son? So War Prism takes some damage, but it will survive for now. Plus two is almost done for Patience, but he's still in a lot of trouble. The only thing he does have going for himself is that he has all those observers, that he has quite a bit of map vision now, and that he has a cannon in multiple bases. So he's setting himself up pretty okay to at least defend, but just defending when you're down 35 supply already, it's going to get very tricky.
It seems Fantasy, by the way, is a really big fan of going for a lot of bio medivacs and not medivikings. He doesn't like dropping a second starport often, even though Patience most of the time plays with a lot of Colossus.
Yeah, I'm very surprised to see another factory going down. It seems like he really wants to commit to Widowmine production.
Maybe he thought he lost it or something, because that doesn't really make sense.
I'm not sure either. Maybe he just wants to make a bunch of mines. Maybe he wants to throw in some Hellbats because he's worried about the ridiculous amount of
drop in the main. Patience was waiting there, but with the split on those units, they're going to get the Colossus pretty quickly. Photon of a charge is going to be used in the main there. Patience trying to hold on.
The robotics facility thought it's going to go down right before one more Colossus pops. That's very unfortunate for Patience, even though he does clean up the majority of these forces, but there is another squad on the right side. I'm actually surprised that Patience's army looked so big while he's down in supply so much. I feel with the amount of supply advantage that Fantasy had, he doesn't even have to drop anymore. Just go for a straight up attack.
You should have rallied across the map and maybe done the Maru attack, where you attack the third base and drop on top of the Protoss army as well, because Patience has left a lot of units here in his main base waiting for drop. So right now what Fantasy did, played right into his hand, but now Fantasy is setting up for a big attack. He's going to snipe the Observer. Usually you see big drops happening in the main right after this. 115 army supply to 69. That's a pretty big lead there.
Yeah, he's going to go for Drilling Claw Salt on the second factory, which, you know, is very good against armies that rely a lot on Zealots and Archons and maybe Stalkers, but against a player that opened up with a bunch of Colossus, it's a little bit surprising to see it, but I don't mind it. I actually think Drilling Claw Winter Mines are very good against Protoss. You know, it's always a lot of guaranteed damage. Storm is going to go down as well for Patience. Fantasy's maxed out at the moment, guys, despite the fact that he lost a couple of medevacs here and there. 129 army supply. Just attack straight up. Like, you don't have to drop over here, Fantasy. Dropping is awesome if you like, if it's an even game and you try to make something happen, but
scans the main, sees that there's a lot of units there. Resources lost. Fantasy lost a lot more, actually, but he just pulled so far ahead in the start by killing so many probes that he managed to max out so quickly, and now he's going to go for the fight and a big drop in the main at the same time.
Yeah, that's very cool play over here, especially as he
Storm
saw
just
all
completed.
These units. Yeah, Storm just completed, but he lost already one or two High Templars. These Storms are okay as they connect with a couple of these Marauders, but that doesn't change the fact that there is a lot of bio into the main base as well. Could maybe go for a Colossus, as one of them is pretty damn exposed, and at the same time, man, they're just fighting all over the place, but it just seems like it's an unfair fight as Fantasy has just pulled so far ahead in the macro department that it doesn't really matter, as GG is called and Fantasy takes a pretty convincing game one victory.
Yeah, he was 2-2 there in upgrades against just the 2-1 Protoss as well, so definitely made quite a few units there to kill his opponents. And in the end, these drops, even though they got shut down at first, Patience not able to hold on. Even though he completed Storm just before, that's supposed to be good, but I guess he was just so far behind in the end that it didn't matter.
Yeah, he lost one or two High Templars right before Storm finished up as well, I believe. And I do think the play was very cool by Fantasy. He had four medevacs full of bio units ready to drop. He could potentially maybe drop it on top of an army as well if that situation would have occurred. But then he saw the units, he's like, all right, you've got an army in your third base, you've got an army in your natural. That means there is nothing in the main. I've got so much bio, just fly into the main, unload it all, and you gotta make a choice, mate, which army you wanna fight. I got three, you only have two. So well done by Fantasy, just great macro from him, and I love that opening. I think it's very weird that opening fell so out of fashion, because I think that 8 marine drop into the main base, into a couple of Hellions, into the natural, I think it's a very strong opening for Tower.
Yeah, but remember, there's nothing in StarCraft 2 that's safe against everything, and I guess if you know that a turn likes to do this a lot, there's definitely a few good ways that you can open and properly counter this and do very well against it. So far, like, if you look at the bracket of this tournament, it looks like it's very likely that we're going to have three Terrans and one Zerg in the semifinals, with maybe the Zerg winning the whole thing. That'd be interesting. Mm-hmm. But Patience here, he needs to fight back. He won last time these two played with a 3-2 score, you know, close games.
Yeah,
and he had actually lost the first game.
Exactly. I was about to say, back then, Fantasy 2 game number one as well. So this series is far from over. It will most likely be a pretty back and forth series. But game number one, Fantasy did look very promising. It just looked good from start to finish. I like the idea of Patience to pull the probes from the natural into the main base, so you only have to defend one location against that marine drop and the Hellion run by. But then he kind of just let them long distance mine, and he still ended up losing 6-7 workers. And then the mine follow up was awesome as well by Fantasy. Just a great build and great execution. That's all there is to it.
All right, we're on Cactus Valley here, and starting on the top right hand side, playing as the blue Protoss. He needs to bring it back. It is Patience.
A cheeky guy. Always so calm, very smiley, in and out of the games. Doesn't really matter whether he wins or loses, he's always friendly. On the left top side of Cactus Valley, we're looking at the main base of a Brood War legend. Wants to continue that legacy in StarCraft 2, it is Fantasy. Definitely played a couple of great games over the years, Todd. But still waiting for that one tournament where everybody will... Whenever you say Fantasy in StarCraft 2, people will say like, oh yeah, he won. You know, because so far he didn't really win anything. Had a couple great games here and there, and everyone knows that he's very good. It was an SKT1 for a long time. Of course, had pretty much the best practice a man could get, but he wanted to try his chances abroad. And he had a couple already. Didn't really go all the way yet. This could be his weekend. Would be a remarkable victory. Fantasy would go all the way here at IEM Gamescom when there is players like Innovation and
Sue. A lot of fans would go crazy, I think.
Yeah, I know. It's nostalgia, man.
Yeah. The last time these two played here on this map, Patience went for a Proxys target. We actually just watched that VOD, and when you saw it, you said, oh, it's the good old Maximus Black build. what do you think is the likelihood here? He goes for something like this here once again.
There's no way Fantasy forgot about that build, right? Well, he is taking double gas. Yeah,
that's the beauty of the Maximus Black builds. You can know about it, you can prepare for it. You will die to it.
Well, there is a reason Maximus Black led us on the barcade, though. Like, it is slightly better when you don't expect it.
Yeah.
So there is a chance that Fantasy is going to gamble a little bit, that Patience is going to gamble, that he just sends a probe across the map. Well, he's getting his second pylon at home, so far there is no man overboard.
For those of you who don't know the build we're just talking about, it's a Proxys target with an Oracle first, and then you get Void Race, you add on additional gateways on one single base, and then you go for a big bust, which actually back then was a pretty slow one, with Patience using a lot of hold position with his Stalkers and Void Race to take out units very, very slowly. And this time, Fantasy is opening a lot more safe. Last time, I think it was a command center first with a late scout. That's why he really didn't see it coming and started taking a lot of damage from the start. This time, Reaper, much, much, much safer.
And with last time, we of course referred to the previous series that these two players played against each other. In the previous game, Fantasy also opened up different, where it was just Marines into an Expand and then into these Hellions. This time he's going to open up with a Reaper, maybe because Cactus Valley is such a big map. He wants to have a fast-moving unit out early on so he can keep track on Patience, as Patience is a rather crazy Protoss. But so far everything looks very standard for our blue Protoss, as he just went for a quick Nexus and a Mothership Core. Pretty much the most common opening in the Protoss playbook.
Whereas Fantasy stopped mining gas after the initial 100 for a Reaper and a Reactor, he shuts down that Proban on the map, and now he's going to drop down another barracks. So the good old Bomber / Bolt build, I guess.
Yeah, I like this a lot, Todd, because the only criticism I had after watching his games with Fantasy is that it's either CC first into a lot of racks, or it was Reaper into...
Factory
after the command center on the low ground, and it becomes a little bit predictable. But now he's really switching it up a lot. He's going 3 racks on Cactus Valley, and there is a chance that Patience is going to try to hard counter, you know, a potential Widowmine drop. So he's going to open up with a Twilight Console and just chrono boost out a lot of probes at first. And you don't have a lot of units then, because there is a chance he's going to go Twilight into Robo. And we saw that earlier in this tournament, if you go Twilight and Robo, you just don't have a lot of gateway units. Then if the Terran knocks on your front door with 3 Rex aggression, it's damn hard to deal with.
Yeah, it can be really tough. And having spotted Twilight there, Fantasy already going to know that it's either Blink or Dark Templars. He can start getting prepared for either with an eBay in not too long.
Of course, Patience does not know what we know. He doesn't know that he's playing against his 3 Rex opening from Fantasy. If there was one way for him to figure it out, there we go. There's the robotics facility as a follow-up. Now, I'm very, very familiar with this scenario, Todd, because I'm a Starborn Protoss myself, and I often just assume that the Terran player is going to go Reaper into CC, into Factory, and then when they knock on my door with a bunch of Marauders, Concussive Shells, and, you know, let's say 10 Marines, Photon Overcharge is good, And if you have to believe certain Terran streamers, it's very good, but it's not that good that you're not going to lose anything. Well, what was that game we saw earlier this tournament on Iron Fortress between a Protoss and a Terran? Was maybe State against a Terran? I kind of forgot, but we saw a game on Iron Fortress that played out exactly
like this. I thought we talked about this, Kev.
Yeah. Don't put you on the spot. Don't ask questions we both don't know the answer to. Well, we'll see. Patience has a couple units, has absolutely no idea that it's coming though. That Mothership Core thought, I hope for Patience that he's paying very close attention. Because if he ends up losing the Mothership Core before Photon Overcharge goes down, this game is 100% over.
Well, no, he's not. He's paying attention. He's going to pull it back. That's a lot of units though. But four Stalkers should be enough to push this back. Even Kai did quite a bit. And there's no... Oh, there is Concussive Shells actually.
Yep. But indeed, four Stalkers. There's only one Marauder. Actually, I felt that Fancy could have more. Fancy left units at home. He must have. A couple. Maybe he's worried about an Oracle, but it
you said the map was what, by the way? Iron Fortress?
Yes, there was an Iron Fortress.
State against 4GG?
Yeah, see? I was on the money, Todd.
Thanks to the equipment, yeah.
State left bottom, 4GG right bottom. There you go, Todd. Can watch the video later. But actually, Fancy not committing to it, and Patience, despite the fact that he didn't really have a whole lot of units, is going to be more than fine. He's going to open up with a War Prism, by the way. Maybe...
Yeah, he wants to have some counter-dropping capability there. You know, load it up with Zealots, and then as soon as Fantasy moves out, he drops that in his base. Usually when you do that, that means you want to go for a third base of your own rather quickly. And actually the Dark Shrine as well here going down. That's the grubby build, no?
Yeah, he did do this a long, long time ago.
Colossus into DTs on Shattered Temple against Clouds.
Yeah, I can't believe that you remember that. I watched a game where he did it in MLG as well. Wow. Nice reaction there by Patience.
Hashtag Roddy Observer.
No, mine flies straight into the missile turret, Todd.
And I don't even look at it.
Yeah, exactly.
I look at once it's dead, I'm like, what's happened there?
That happens so many times to me. I'm really bad with that. Either way, this is quite cool. What I like about this from Patience is that in the previous game, as you guys saw on Coda, he was just defending. Observers in defensive positions, just trying to defend. Never made it to the side of the map from Fantasy. This time, even when it's only a single Zealot, yeah, it's not a lot, but it forces Fantasy to worry about this War Prism for now. He knows it's there, and at least Patience sees so much more. I really like this. Don't lose it.
I think he's going to keep it for some time, and I mean, even if he forces a Viking here, that's a win, because the Terran's going to stay on his side of the map, and usually in the meantime, you go for a third base. I'm just afraid that Patience, he gets a little bit overeager and actually tries to commit to this too much and loses a lot, because there is the turret up in the main.
Yep. A very good point there. There's a turret
right next to it
at the starport.
He saw it. Building.
And this time it's Rex number 4 and 5 as well, Todd, before... Oh, there we go, Sim.
Do it.
Man. If I was Patience right now, I'd be, the War Prism solo on HP is going to drop the high Dark Templar. And the War Prism lives, and he also forces out a scan, so that's pretty damn useful. How much does Patience have at home? Does he have his first Colossus already?
Yeah,
yes, he does. He should be more than fine.
Nothing to tank, though.
Micro the Colossus.
He's going to lose it pretty quickly. The Stalkers are going down, and Sentries are going to die very quickly to this as well. Patience needed a few Zealots at the front to really help and tank some damage, and he needed to micro as well. I think using a time warp in that fight would have been brilliant.
He didn't even have to fight there. Like, he has a Mothership Core there, he could just stand back, he could have dropped better force fields, he could have kept the Colossus alive, and like you said, one or two Zealots, it sounds silly, but two Zealots already changes the entire dynamic of that battle. Ignore the Zealots, they'll do a lot of damage. Shoot at the Zealots, the Colossus is going to do a lot of damage. It's as simple as that.
Yeah, you need some mid-shield at the front. You can't let your Stalkers and Colossus be the units that are attacked, because they will fall very quickly, even to just a few Marines and Marauders when they have Steam Pack and plus one. These guys are already pretty mean. Observer's going to get sniped there, and that is the first one that gets sniped out of three Observers that were made, so just two left for Patience.
That's
there.
A lot of damage output on this Nexus. You really want to keep this Nexus alive, Patience, but I'm afraid that Fancy is going to commit to it. He's going to right-click on the Nexus, and he is going to force the cancel.
And Blink is not finished, so he can't even chase.
Very
double
well
forge behind this. I really like Fantasy, by the way, what he did at his third base. He put a turret and sent some units there, really hoping that the DT gets sent in, like I would have done.
Yeah, he's just thinking ahead of the situation. Fantasy is playing phenomenal so far. I thought really clean play in
the
both
prism
games.
In the main.
There's a Viking shooting at the War Prism. That War Prism was already a prisoner of war, Todd, because he was never supposed to leave. They were waiting for him on both sides. Couldn't really go anywhere. Oh, There we go.
By the way, Patience has a lot of probes. Oh my god, I just noticed. 64 on two bases. Well, he's trapped on two bases. And
he wasn't supposed to be on two bases.
Yeah. And this, but still, that's a lot.
I feel this is the phase in the game where Cactus Valley becomes an incredibly difficult map because there is so much area that Medivacs can fly into your main base, even run into the natural. And at the same time, you have to keep a lot of units at the third base. Like, if you take a look at the main base of Patience right now, how much does he have over there? Does Patience have any units in his main base?
He has a few. He had a bunch of Stalkers. He's actually sending them back right now because he realized that Fantasy might be attacking at the third base. He's trying to catch those Medivacs. Blink is about to finish, but he's not up yet. It's 10 seconds.
Oh, God. If these Medivacs fly north now, this is already going to get a little bit tricky. Photon Overcharge is available, though.
Oh, the dance, man.
Yeah. I find this very difficult. I do like the Observer.
He's going to scan for the Observer as well.
Yeah.
So he's shut down so much of the vision of Patience there. That's the third Observer that died there. He's only one left. And right now, it's with the army here of Patience. So Patience's vision right now, it's gone. He really doesn't see much.
I'm such a jinx, Todd. I'm like, I do really like the Observer for Patience. And it's like, boom. It's like, Patience is like, thanks, Rod. That was a great call.
You really do surprise me.
Well, he's just going to bring all the units down right now as he still has one more. Oh, my God. Fantasy is just flying around with so much bio. Still has to be careful, though, because the Stalker count is high. Forward blink there. But if he flies everything into the main, these units, this is not even enough, I think. If all these bio units are unloaded, well, maybe with the second Colossus and a Photon Overcharge.
Yeah. He's got some cannons, actually. Some in-control cannons. Oh, if he can snipe some of those Medivacs before they can actually unload. These Stalkers are behind enemy lines there.
Well, he got both Medivacs. He got two Medivacs. Oh, my God. Those Widomites did a lot of damage, though. But I still think it's going to be enough. Fancy lost a lot of units there. Good defense by Patience.
And Patience has enough as well at the third base that if he had been attacked there, he would have defended easily. He's still quite a bit behind in supply. Yeah.
I hope he knows about those Widomines, by the way. Is he making an Observer? Yes, he is. Because that could have gone very, very painful very quickly.
Look at those beautiful in-control cannons in the main. They are ready to wrestle down any kind of bio that gets in there.
You need it, man. Cactus Valley is very difficult to play super late game against Terran. So I like Patience is rather safe than sorry. He's getting a couple of backup cannons. You just want to get that, man.
Patience, his plan is simple there. Kill as much bio as he can, keep on defending, build up his Colossus count, and then potentially go for a timing of his own. He's going to start 2-2, finally feels comfortable enough to start it. And he's evened up the supply very nicely. 96 army supply to 102.
I think Fantasy should ignore the main base for now, and he should try to attack the third base from the south side. Just stim in and try to right-click on the Nexus, because there isn't really a whole lot of vision on the south side.
He's going for the big Doom Drop.
Oh my god, he's going to blink on top of that army again. Patience, it's quite risky.
His other chunk of army was not too far there for Patience, so he's going to get a full army fight against full army. It's going to be ideal for him.
Yep. I actually think this is pretty okay for Patience, even though there's still a lot of Medivacs over here. But one more Medivac will get picked off, and it was full of units. Patience taking a supply lead, probably for the first time in this series. He's on double fours, he's on three bases. There is no Viking production on the way. There are no ghosts on the way. I think this has been going extremely well for Patience.
Some might say he's been really patient, Roddy. He never started charge, though. Because of all the action that's been happening, he forgot about charge. We've seen before how this can be a huge disadvantage in some of those fights. You need charge as soon as he's going to start building up his Zealot count. He's on 17 already.
Oh, man. The drop defense has been so good so far, but Fancy is relentless, and he's just going to try it one more time. Widomines will connect with a couple of these probes, and with a couple, I mean 14 or even 15. There go the in-control cannons. Maybe he's going to be able to get a Forge as well. No plus 3 armor for you, matey. Or is that plus 2 armor?
That was plus 2 as well.
Plus 2 armor?
Yeah. So it's going to be 2 attack and 1 armor here in a moment. Templar Archives is going to start, as well as another Forge there.
The thing is,
he's relentless.
You know this about Cactus Valley. It is very, very difficult as a Protoss to move out. Because you know, every single time you move out, it turns into a base trade. There's like no in between because there's so much mobility for all these Medivacs and stuff. Very smart. Dark Templar there, the fourth base, should be able to cancel it pretty much immediately.
There's still some unit in the third base. I really like this here by Fantasy.
Yep. Doesn't use F2. He's a bigger man than I am, Todd. Those units, if this was my army, if this was my Terran game, they would have marched across the map a long time ago. This time he's going via the south side, by the way, on the third base, and I like that. Even though Patience has a lot of units there, and he's going to catch it indeed.
I think he's going to realize soon that there is no charge, because right now he looks at the Zealots. They're like, why are you guys so slow?
A couple of Dark Templars in the front as well.
Oh, Fantasy wants to fight?
They will get a few swipes off.
Oh, Patience is moving out at the top with the big chunk of his army. He's close. He's got more supply. This is looking very scary. 135 army supply to 94, Roddy.
Yeah, that's actually pretty
insane. Oh my god, if he was to attack there, There is not many Vikings at all. There is one Viking against seven Colossi. Oh my God!
I love the random. I love the random Widomites for fantasy. But Patience has been extremely good with his reserves. I'm very impressed with Patience this game, Todd. This was not an easy game to play out, but he's really made the best of it. And now for the first time, he really showed some. You know, he put some real scare into fantasy. He's like, hey, look at my army. I can actually start attacking you soon. So fantasy brought back the other units because he's like, maybe I can fight my entire army against half of your army. But that allowed Patience to regroup as well.
Patience is about to get a 8 Colossi against one single Viking. I know Maru can win without Vikings against Colossus, but there are limits, I think.
And this is indeed, this reminds me a little bit of Maru Deer back in the days where it's just only Marines, only Marauders. It's a very fun playstyle for a Terran, but most of the time there is a timer on for how long can you win this game, you know? Against 3-4 Colossus, it's still doable. Yeah. Maybe against 5 if you start dropping, but in a straight-up engagement, this is going to be the Terran Massacre of the Century. Yeah. Like, he's not going to kill anything.
I think Patience is going to go for it with Storm, by the way, as well. And there's no Ghosts. Fantasy is just kind of sitting there at that fourth base trying to secure it, so he's... I think he's going to be in trouble there in a second, unless he can drop and do a lot
base
of damage.
Yeah, he can't fight the army straight up. I think he's going to go for the base trade pretty much immediately. You cannot fight an army.
Look at how he says it's setting up, though. He's not looking like he wants to base trade.
No, he can't fight it.
Scans and sees the army headed his way. I don't think he can pick up and leave there. It's too risky. He's going to go for the fight.
Yeah, you're right, actually. He's spreading out his units like he wants to fight, but there's no way against Storm, against this many Colossus.
8 Colossi.
Yeah.
8 against one Viking.
Good luck, have fun.
Which is actually not even in the fight.
Make it a lazy show, Patience. This is your moment. You have to wait probably 22 minutes to get in this position to finally be able to attack. But the moment you will, it's going to go well. I like the idea of Fantasy. He's going to drop a couple of Marauders. Actually, a lot of Widowmines. Will they be able to connect with these Colossus? Well, a little bit, but not enough. The idea was there with Drilling Claws as well. Awesome idea, but it was just not enough. Patience has been too solid this game. Defending non-stop against drops on Cactus Valley, and it's very difficult to always have your units in the right position, but he did it, and he takes a commanding army supply advantage.
That was the most one-sided fight I've seen in a long time there. 8 Colossi against just, I guess we can say 0 Vikings, because that one guy was even on strike.
He plays Marine Marauder Widowmine. I think the idea with the mines was very cool.
Yeah, he needed to do way more damage for this to work, like Kill Nexus, and then GG will be called, and Patience brings it back after a rather long game.
Yeah. But if that would have worked out, we would have been screaming our lungs out. We would be like, oh my god, 10 Widowmines just killed 7 Colossus.
Yeah. No, you are absolutely right, though. If you can't beat your opponent's army, and like, it's not like he didn't see it coming too. He was scanning.
Yeah.
He saw the 8 Colossi. Yeah, he should pick up and try and drop. Like, you see this army, like, the last thing I want to do ever is fight it. Mm-hmm. Doesn't make any sense. In this case, he fought.
And Cactus Valley is a pretty okay base trade map as well. Yeah. So you can maybe start somewhere, but it was just kind of funny. It looked like, you know, like a featherweight boxer walks into the gym and he sees there is a heavyweight training, and then he puts on the gloves and he's like, all right, bring it on. You know, that's kind of how that looked. It's like you're staring at 8 Colossus with Marines and Marauders. The idea with the mines was cool, but like you mentioned, Todd, I think he just didn't do enough economic damage throughout the game.
Yeah, there was one time he started to do a little bit with one of the drops at the top because Patience had left his base too early, but in the end, I was defended. And even though the Forge Snipe was really nice in the end, it didn't really achieve nearly enough for Fantasy there. So in this case, no Ghosts, no Vikings against High Templars and Colossus. We all know how that goes.
You know what I think Fantasy could have done maybe a little bit better? Every single time he tried to drop into the main base, he dropped very near the ramp, which means that the Colossus would always be able to get a first swipe off or a second swipe off. Well, I think at Cactus Valley, there's quite a bit of surface area into the main base. If he flies all the way north into the main base, he can unload these bio units. And everyone knows a Terran drop is 100 times harder to deal with when all units are unloaded already and ready to fire rather than them being unloaded one by one and often dying one by one, or one out of three units will die immediately.
And look at Patience taking a few sips there. Hmm. That's not water. That's Terran tears right there. Okay, maybe not yet. Well, he's still got a few games to win.
We don't want
to
pull a Bly over here. Let's not dance our units in game number one.
Hashtag patience on fire.
Our third map in this series is going to be Bridgehead. It could be potentially a very fun map as well. I'm even more excited now about these next three games because I love this playstyle of fantasy. I am not sure if this is the best way to play for a Terran, but it does often provide the most entertaining games, and it gives us a lot of action. It gives us a lot of, you know, potential really cool moments.
All right, here we go on Bridgeheads. Roddy, are you ready? Yeah. Starting on the left-hand side, playing as the blue Protoss. He also plays for Dead Pixels, as they both do. It is Patience What a cutie. You just gotta say it every single time. When you look at Paige, you're like, ah.
That's the first thing that comes to my mind.
You cheeky guy, you.
On the right side of Bridgehead, we're looking at the Terran that looked phenomenal in game one, still looks solid in game two. It is Fantasy. What do you think Fantasy's thinking of right now, Todd? Of lasers?
Yeah, he's probably thinking that he needs to drop more. Either like play the late game or commit more to aggression if he has no plan into going with making more Vikings or even Ghosts, because you can't just max out like this on bio on the ground against Colossus and High Templars, unless you want a base trade.
You know, if Fantasy ever bought any tickets for an upcoming EDM festival, he just put them on eBay. He's like, I've seen too many lasers already. Like, no more laser nights, I'm done. I just want to sit at home.
You know what they say, though, if you can't beat him, join him. Maybe he'd be the one using those lasers.
I can see Fantasy organizing a pretty cool party. Why not?
His nickname is Fantasy, after all.
It's going to be a Rex into a refinery over here. Could be the same build as game number one, Bridgehead. Ooh.
Patience is super paranoid. He scouted a lot for proxies, and he's going to use that at the same time to go for his own proxy. And I'm pretty sure he's going to be a Stargate if he goes for one.
Yeah, Bridgehead is an excellent map for proxy Stargates. He's going to get his second guess a little bit later.
Maximus Black is being summoned.
Channel your inner bowels right now, Patience. There we go. For a proxy target, it's pretty far away off. Then again, it will be borderline impossible for Fantasy ever to scout it, because who would ever scout that tiny little cordon on the south side of Bridgehead over there?
Yeah, I guess he wants to make sure that it's a lot less likely that he's going to be scouted, because if the Terran opens Reaper, you know he's going to have a lot of speed to go around and explore the map with. So feels like in this corner it's going to be less. Are you feeling a Twilight and Dark Templar?
Yeah, maybe, because the position is just so off, but I do like what you say over there. Then again, this is not really a Reaper map, and not a whole lot of Terrans like to go for Reaper.
Yeah.
But I think you're onto something, Todd. For some reason, I'm feeling Twilight into Dark Shrine, and I have no idea why, but
that Roddy Spider Sense.
Yeah.
Let's see if it's right once again. It's rarely wrong, actually. Yeah. I remember you making weird calls like, what was it, like Dark Templars and Alter Gym? I was like, no, you fool, that didn't make sense. And then the one guy went for it. But in this case, it's actually a Stargate.
Yeah, I mean, like, the cool thing about this is, like, once more, that this will most likely not get spotted. The last thing you want to do with a quick proxy Stargate is to be it spotted very easily by the first SCV or the first Marine. Reapers, in general, scout a little bit better. Well, he's surprisingly
close.
See it. Yeah, he should be able to see it. Fantasy's probably thinking as well. He's like, okay, well, the target is red a long ways off.
I think Fantasy realizes that, you know, Patience, he won a nice game last game, but his style overall is almost always going to be, you know, heavy aggression like this. So putting a lot of effort into scouting like this is exactly what he needs to be doing for pretty much the entire series. So seeing that target there, even seeing that it's an Oracle, it's a pretty big information. Like, the Widow Mines that he can set up are going to be pretty important.
What I'm very excited about right now, Todd, is where are the Widow Mines going to be? And there you go, man. These Terrans, they just get more and more sneaky each given day when it comes to where to position their mines. There are so many moments right now. Like, in this day and age of PvT, Todd, I don't even have any ambitions or dreams anymore to keep my Oracles alive, because I know I can't go anywhere.
But I think that's what Patience is going to do is just fly around the edge here, not go too close. He's going to see that there is in fact a factory, and probably just go back home, wait there for it, if there is a Widowmine drop, and get Phoenixes. Mm. So he's going to use the Oracle to reveal, pick up the Widowmines and kill them, and play it defensively, which I really like, because he's put Fantasy in the defensive posture himself there.
Yep, it wasn't really a gas first, but it's still a one base opening over here for Fantasy, so it's not very economic. And with these kind of openings in general, you want to do some damage as a Terran. No Terran opens up with a command center at 6 minutes and 20 seconds to not kill any probes. He wants to do some magic with this. Hellions are cruising to the other side of the map as well, but the first Phoenixes are out. Photon Overcharge is not ready, but he should still have more than enough DPS. Come on, use your Oracle. Should have been on top of these Marines. Marines are going to shoot at the Oracle. Will it be enough damage?
Hellions are getting in, though. They might be able to get a lot of kills. Patience wasn't looking. Oh my god, that splash. He's going to start losing a lot of probes there. Five already have gone down.
And he's going to lose way more than this, Todd. It's 8 already. Phoenixes will eventually be able to take care of the medevac, but he's lost so many workers already. Oh my god, 14 workers have gone down.
Yeah, this is bad. He's down to just 12 probes against 27 SCVs. And
he's going to lose his stalker. Maybe even the Mothership Corners will know.
Five hit points.
Saved by the bell. Or in this case, the Graviton Beam, but still. That was still a ridiculously successful opening by Fantasy. And I don't understand why Patience was not sending his Phoenix in immediately. He saw the medevac.
Yeah.
He could have been on top of the medevac. It's almost like he wanted Fantasy to unload all the units because he thought he could easily kill it. But then he was just a little bit too late. If the Oracle is hovering above the medevac and the Marines...
That one hurts.
But if those Marines get dropped one by one out of medevac, the Oracle kills all of them immediately. Yeah. Like, he barely will take any damage, then the Phoenixes can chip away that medevac. Patience could have handled that 100 times better.
Fantasy still has an SCV inside Patience's base, by the way.
Phoenix goes down, Todd, and one other Phoenix.
That SCV is going to see the Robo. You know what would have been sick if he had made a bunker between both bases to kind of cover the next drop he can do. But in this case, we have Patience still trying to be aggressive with the Phoenixes. He feels like he has to, and he might have to, I mean. Just fell so far behind here with all of those probes that he lost, 14 in total. Right now it's 24 probes, 29 CV. So he caught back up nicely, but against a Tian on double orbital, you're still in trouble.
Yeah, that's a pretty horrific situation to be in. Any Terran being up 5-6 workers in a 9-minute game when you don't really have any great tech yet. There's no Colossus, there's no Charge, no Storm, no Blink. Like Phoenixes, they fall off rather quickly. They're pretty good in their wrestling. They're very annoying, but as a Terran, you just gotta accept that you will lose a couple SCVs here and there. But your ground, oh my god, I cannot believe that that just happened. End up losing two more Phoenixes. This is a horrific game for Patience, man. Everything is going wrong.
Yeah, it's been difficult, let's just say that.
And this
he's
is what
so many units.
This is personally thought why I never play Stargate against Terran, because this happens to me all the time.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter where my Phoenixes fly, they're magnets for Widowmines.
That's why when I watch Classics games, I get so mad. Because he just dodges everything, like snipes every single Widowmine, and like keeps all of his targets alive perfect.
Yeah.
Even the...
Trap.
Even, yeah, Trap.
So sick.
Trap with an Oracle, like...
Yeah, I know.
He plays another game.
I hate it. I hate watching it because it looks almost overpowered, and then you try it and you just look like a fool because your units just keep flying into Widowmines. So far, Fantasy, of course, we've got to give him mad props for the smart Widowmine positioning that he's been going for so far. And of course, that very successful drop here. Like, you don't see them anymore, I thought. You just don't see them.
Yeah. Fantasy gonna drop racks 4 and 5 there before going for a third commencer, which I do think he's gonna get in not too long. And another observer gets sniped.
I don't want to be a Debbie Downer, but as soon as these units have Stim, I think this game will just end immediately.
He's got the one-click defense, Photon Overcharge.
Yeah, lovely.
Kappa.
Against the 6 Marauders with Stim, Todd.
There's quite a few Phoenixes, to be honest.
Yeah, you know what Marines do to Phoenixes, Todd?
Not when there's 2 Zealots and a Sentry on the ground, Roddy, come
yes,
on.
Yes, they will. You want to bet?
Well, with the next wave, I guess... another... Fantasy doesn't like these observers. He's the new Teja.
I remember those
Funka
guys.
Is scared right now. you're next, Funka.
First in-game observers, then the real-life ones. You guys wonder why Adebisi retired? Fantasy had a little chat with him. I mean, this Army of Fantasy is just so much stronger than the Army of Patience.
He's going to so many Phoenixes.
You think he's
Patience
kill it
knows
again?
He needs to do something drastic.
You think he's going to kill
yeah,
it?
Yeah, of course.
Funka, be scared. He's coming for you, Funka. Lock the door.
The units are in the natural there for Patience. And when I say the units, it's 3 Zealots and 1 Sentry to try and buy some time for his Phoenixes to do something.
Once again, don't want to be a Debbie Downer, but this Army of Terran is so much stronger than the Army of Protoss. There's going to be a Widowmine drop in the natural as well. There
That's
is no
so
observer over here.
He went in, killed the Cybercore, and then left. The terrorist Terran, man. He's back at it.
This is a very frustrating game right now for Patience. He knows he's in a pretty horrific position. With one Colossus...
Oh, the Medivac got away.
That, of course, changes things a little bit. Does he have an observer, Todd?
Yeah, he's sending it at the natural to clean those Widow Mines, but Fantasy, that's his cue to go into the main and try and get a good fight there, even against the Photon Overcharge. He snipes a pylon immediately, unpowers that gateway, starts chipping at those units and probes, got a sentry very quickly. First Colossus is out.
Yeah, that's kind of what he needed. So now at least he will be able to clean up this army, as of course there is no retreat against all these Phoenixes. A couple of these Marauders being picked up as well, and the Colossus will take care of the Marines. But 18 workers, Todd. And look at this, and look at the minimap in the natural now again. Fantasy is relentless. Fantasy is all over game number 3, and Patience knows it. GG is called. Fantasy takes a 2-1 lead. Sick play.
Yeah, great performance there. Fantasy, you can really feel like if he starts getting into his comfort zone and he takes no damage early on and he's the one actually doing some damage, it's actually really hard to come back in this kind of game against him. He just knows, you know, to go for every single proper step, keep on applying pressure and at the same time, you know, macro properly with the additional barracks, tech, and even third base that he wants to go for. So that was very, very good here by him.
Yep, it's been a cool series so far. We're going to head over to a very small break, or at least for the players. Maybe we'll just stay on air, because now I'm not 100% sure anymore, Todd. Okay, so we are going to go throw it to a very small break, as the players maybe have to go to the restroom and stuff. And after that, we'll be back with the conclusion of the second quarterfinal of the Intox Remasters Cologne. Stay tuned. Alrighty, welcome back to day 4 of the Intox 3 Masters Cologne, where we're getting closer and closer to leaving this place and going to the big venue, where of course tomorrow the semi-finals and finals will be played. Early today we already saw Su advancing to the semis. That was not a big surprise. This series, Todd, is still up for grabs.
Yeah, these two, they've had quite a few, well, I guess they actually only played once, but they have quite a few close games. Mm-hmm. One very close series in the end. That was just last month, and back then it was Patience. I was able to win 3-2, pretty deep into the tournament as well. And so now, round of eight, Fantasy finally, you know, properly shows up, scouts a lot. He loses one map, but he's up 2-1. Match points. Do you think Patience keeps on, you know, keeping things a little bit crazy here on Terraform, or does he maybe slow down a little bit, get a little bit shy because of how it has gone in the previous map?
The previous game wasn't even that crazy. It was a proxy Stargate, but it wasn't of the second pylon, so it wasn't like he committed a whole bunch. And then I like that
It was the second pylon, I think.
No, it was the third pylon.
You sure?
It was a little later. He had a 5-minute expand as well. So he wasn't super greedy, I think. So overall, it all made sense. And I think his opening was supposed to do quite well against the opening of Fantasy. I just really think that Patience kind of dropped the ball on when those units were starting to unload. He could have had the Oracle on top of the Medevac. Then Marines are being unloaded one by one. They die one by one. Either way, he will probably look at that as a missed opportunity as well. But he's not down and out yet. He's spawning on the right bottom side of Terraform. It is Patience.
And his opponents, starting on the top left-hand side, they are playing as the Red Terran. It is his teammates, Fantasy.
Definitely brought us a very entertaining playstyle so far in TVP. Keeps it fresh as well. Three games, three completely different openings. That's something we mentioned in the start of the series. It's really important for Terran to keep the variety there. And if you're not a super diehard Starker fan or not a super diehard Starker fan, player or a Terran fan, they may be like, well, doesn't it always look the same? Like, he's getting a lot of Marines and Marauders. There are so many ways you can get there. In the first game, he opened up with a few Marines, then went into a CC, then went into more Marines and Hellion Harass. Second game, he opened up with a Reaper, and then third game, he opened up kind of gas first, but then it was just Marines into, you know, two Hellions as well, but then of one base. Well, in game number one, he did it of two bases. So there's been a lot of variation so far in the openings of Fantasy, and that makes it so much harder for someone like Patience to truly prepare and to truly be ready for what is coming.
What do you think about Fantasy's nickname, the Terrorist?
I think it's kind of rude.
Do you know why that's his nickname?
Tell me.
Because, that's what Liquipedia says, and Liquipedia is always right anyway. Because he had the excellent dropship and vulture control in all matchups. Okay. So I guess he was like a little bit everywhere and blowing stuff up.
I mean, his game, even the game that he lost, I think looked really cool.
Yeah, he's very good with drops. Yep. I think everybody will agree on that.
Yeah, I mean, on Coda, that was awesome, right? How he did it in the end. He's like, okay, I have 4 medevacs full of bio units. Let's just look for an opportunity. Maybe I'll drop it behind the army. Maybe I'll drop it in the main. Then he went for the main. That's just cool play, you know? It's not that he picked him up and then he went for it. He already had him picked up because he was planning for something like that all along.
Yeah.
So that's a really cool one.
Patience is trying to fake that he's proxying his target, but Fantasy actually didn't quick scout with NSCV there. He's only going to rely on his Reaper. So I wonder if he actually fall for it. I don't think so. Zealot will be canceled and Nexus will start, and then we'll have the Mothership Core starting. And I think Fantasy might not even be able to see that there is no second pylon in the main, and he's not going to be worried at all. So Patience wanted to try something here to trick Fantasy, and I feel like it's not going to work at all.
Later, of course, it's always nice to have a pylon in the back of your natural, because if you feel like there will be Widowmine drops, you could potentially get a Forge, and you can already wipe in a cannon into your natural mineral line.
He might go Stargate, actually. Patience likes to open Stargate, get Phoenixes, and get ready to defend against you know, any kind of Widowmine drop.
I'm kind of feeling some Twilight play here, Todd, because there's no ramp.
DTs?
No, just Blinkstalker, but a lot of aggression. Mm-hmm. Not like Blinkstalker to defend. I feel like he's going to try to defend the first drop, and then he's going to counterattack immediately on the other side of the map.
Usually, Patience, in a best of five, he likes to go DTs at least once. The last time that these two play was on Coda, they went for DTs. Now, this map is pretty damn good, especially, you know, that pylon and the natural can, you know, get DTs in very quickly. But now, Terrans, they really started figuring out how to, you know, see it coming, defend a lot better against it. So we'll see.
Well, the Twilight is on the way, Todd, so both options are still very alive, but I just have that feeling that we're going to see some aggressive Blink play this game from Patience, as he's just being rather passive in this series. Patience, you said it in the start of the series, is kind of like Stardust, likes to be aggressive. Ah, it's going to be Dark Shrine for now.
I like actually the main game. Oh, there isn't the pylon in the main to prevent the Reaper from getting in there very easily, so the Dark Shrine will be spotted pretty much instantly, which I think a lot of the time here is going to mean a cancel.
Yeah.
Or do you play the reverse mind game? The last time that these two played on this map, there was a 5-gate blink all-in, which actually succeeded by Patience. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think builds like that are great on maps where there is no ramp into the natural. It makes it very tricky for Terran to have the units in the right spot all the time. Fancy is playing with fire, by the way. He's insane. He just didn't even get a bunker in his natural while he's going Reaper, CC, Factory. If Patience would have walked across the map with two Stalkers and a Mothership Core, the game can potentially end there. The Dark Shrine did get cancelled, and Blink is on the way
but
now.
But usually there will be Widow Mines, though, with this build, but in this case he was setting up for the defense for something
else. He's
going
to kill the Stalker with the Reaper, actually.
Rip.
Kind of sloppy there by Patience.
Patience proxying. He's actually going to go on the offensive. Look at this. He's warping in Stalkers across the map there.
Okay, we're finally going to get a bunker. That's about time, Fancy.
He did cancel the Dark Shrine, but...
He's going to fly maybe over the Stalkers. Yes, he's going to get a couple first hits off. I don't think he's going to kill the Medevac here, but this is so nice already, because that Medevac is quite low on HP. That bunker finishing up is going to actually save Fantasy for now, otherwise he would have just been dead.
Patience going into a third gateway here, by the way, as well. He's still making probes. He's going to get his first observer there out of the Robo in a second. He knows that the Medivac's probably headed for the natural, so he's got the Photon of a Charge ready to be used. But a Reaper will go into the main. It's probably going to force at least one Stalker being warped there with the gateway they just morphed in.
Well, both Widow Mines will be unloaded. Will they shoot? Nope, they won't actually
shoot. Oh, he scans to try and get the observer, and he gets it.
That's That's very, very, very smart. Meanwhile, Stalker, I hope that he knows about this, by the way. Did Patience realize that he lost the Observer?
He made another one, which is rallied there already. Yeah. So he's going to be able to get that before the Widowmine can shoot again. Patience, he might just have to pull back there against two bunkers, like he's already forced these two. Steampack and Combat Shield is going to start really late this game because of all that happened. You know, those barracks are going to be swept now for add-ons. And Fantasy.
Yeah, he could still try to blink into the main base. He doesn't have Stim and stuff right now. Like
this
said,
is really okay here for Patience.
Yeah, I know. If he can get like the tech lab once, there aren't that many bio units. I would go for it, man. A crazy blink in the main, get a tech lab. Why not? Let's roll the dice. I know patients like to have a cheeky visit to the casino as well. Not as bad as Stardust, but.
And with the Fortune Robo Bay on the way here, it's just going to be the standard, you know, blink into Colossus. Wouldn't be surprised if Patience went for a third base there as well. Then again, if there is one Protoss, you know, that can mix in a few good two bases, and on this map that could be also very good, I think it's Patience.
It reveals the fact that Blink has finished up. Fantasy may leave a few more units into the main base. I kind of feel whenever you have scenarios like this, like I don't think it's that bad for Patience. I just feel trying to one time get a tech lab that has either combat shield or stim on the way. I just feel that's so massive and it's almost always worth the risk. Because you can always check with your observer as well to see how many units are waiting for you.
He starts a Nexus before getting additional gateways, so in this game, at the 12th or 13th minute, there is going to be a moment when the Army of Fantasy is going to be massive, like, you know, 80 plus against 40 or 50 plus for Patience. And he's going to have a big window to try and do some damage, but the first Colossus has now started and is about halfway through down there for Patience. He actually went for the attack upgrade instead of armor.
Fantasy goes for 3 CC as well before Rex number 4 and 5, which I think will work out okay. Oh no, actually he already has Rex 4 and 5. Oh man.
That's why I said his production, I think, is going to be massive. 12th minute, 13th minute. Totally could see 80 supply against just 50, in which case drops are going to be deadly. Photon of a charge or not.
Yeah, this is very difficult. This is actually one of the most difficult moments, I think, for Protoss, when you only have maybe one, two Colossus, and like, how do you split up your army? He did a very, very good job on Cactus Valley, though, and I do like, just press the vision right now from Patience real quick. He has a little bit of vision everywhere, you know, an observer here, an observer there. There's a couple pylons well spread out. We'll see that these rocks are being attacked. So he has a good idea. He knows that it's going to be difficult, but at least he will see it coming in time.
He needs a few more gateways though. He's only got three and he's going to be on three bases now with a good saturation, so three gates are not going to be enough. He's going to drop down a few now in the main. And he needs to hold on.
One of the best Terrans in the world struggling to pick up a mine or two. Forward blink, a little bit risky. Fancy really loves Marine Marauder with a mine. He's taking it to the next level though.
He's getting concussive shells now. Yeah, I mean, it can be really good and I guess that's his style. That's probably what he practices most of the time, but He's not looked invincible with it. The one game that he lost, he couldn't do enough damage, and then he just completely died when he got attacked eventually. So this game, he's going to have to do better, because we might have a similar situation. This Colossus, a little bit exposed by himself.
Yep, that's kind of what I would have done as well. Guardian Shield being popped immediately. Force Shield seem okay. One Colossus will maybe fall. No, it will not.
Oh, those Widow Mines just before detonating. He gets sniped. He gets the medivac. Nope. That was so close.
Unloads the mine as well. Still, though, very
good
job.
He could have chased. No?
Very good job, though, there by Patience. Don't you think so, Todd? The time warp immediately, the Guardian Shield, the Force Fields. all the things you want to do as a Protoss, where he previously in the series dropped the ball once on losing a Colossus that he didn't have to lose.
This time, I like what you said. You said kind of like I would have done, except you would have done it better, obviously.
What do you mean?
I'm just making a joke.
I don't get it.
Because you said like he threw down the time warp kind of like you would have done, but Roddy Micro, man, of course you would have done it better. Another observer will fall there. There's, I guess, now only four of them out on the map. And this one should be replaced pretty quickly, but look at this. Already setting up to attack on two sides. They have Fantasy. We're going to have the split from Patience. Very, very... Like, this is looking very much like the Cactus Valley game, but look at this. Fantasy is doing what you said he might have needed to do in the previous time. And attacking around the third base with all of his army, but he gets caught.
Widow Mines, though, do a reasonable amount of damage. There isn't too much to protect these Colossus. The Mothership Core went down. Rebuild that Mothership Core ASAP, Patience. You want to have one of those bad boys flying around. He's not rebuilding it, though. I don't like it. He needs to...
There we go.
Okay.
Restarts it finally. Templar Archive is going to be on the way there as well. 1-1's about to hit for both players in upgrades. And Patience, I quite like the situation there for him. He needs to remember charge this time. How does he forget every time?
I think he also wants to just make sure that he can keep the Colossus production alive. Fantasy right now is just looking for openings. He's like a lion that's on the hunt right now. He's trying to figure it out. Where is the best moment for me to go? Is he going to drop units on top of this Protoss army? Yes, he is. There is no fault in overcharge, but the reinforcements have arrived. Only one Colossus will fall. I think Patience should be able to clean this up with ease. Fantasy is playing a very risky style of terror. And either, you know, it's hell or glory. Either it looks amazing or it just goes horrible. And this time it went pretty horrible.
This didn't do any damage. And Patience might actually attack. Like, this was one of those fights where you kill so much that you're actually thinking, like, should I just attack and try and kill him? Because clearly he's probably not getting the medivac in the main. Oh my god, he caught that. Got it before the Widowmine even drops. Gonna get the Marines as well. So more and more units die. The medivacs are gonna be trapped between the natural and third base. But now a drop in the main by Fantasy is gonna hit, but he's about to die back at home, I think. Because there's two Colossi there and way too many units for him to be able to hold. He might have to evacuate this base.
The Widowmines is scary though. I hope Patience is paying attention to that. He has more Widowmines as well into the main base, but Patience will be able to clean up this drop. And like you said, though, this is
really
an army.
Like,
You gotta respect this army.
Yeah, he sends just a few Zealots in the third base right now. Patience completely take out the economy of Fantasy. At the same time, he's attacking in the natural with everything that he's got, everything else. He defended in the main finally, and Patience taking a big, big supply lead here. He wants to bring it back. He wants to take it to map number 5. And man, these guys, they play some hell of series.
Yep, he has a lot of money as well. He's going to wipe in a couple of high tempos, could land a feedback or two, could
these
get
Archons. Stuck. Yeah, they're stuck between a bunker and a turret.
There's just not enough damage output in his army of Fantasy. This Colossus army is way stronger for Patience. He brought a probe immediately as well to build pylons, reinforce his army, and he's going to even up this series. And it seems like we are going to get ready to head on to the rubber match, as GG is called, and Patience brings it back home, Todd. Brings it back home, at least for now. Really cool game again. And Fantasy... Fantasy's TVP, in a weird way, reminds me a little bit of The Muslim. Like, I watch The Muslim stream a lot, and I like watching Benny. But Ben also plays a very risky style of Terror, right? Like, often going in for drops on top of the Protoss army. And like I said, it's hell or glory. Either it's amazing, or it all comes falling down. And in this case, it was the latter. The other part of Patience's army was just pretty close. And Fantasy could only kill one of the Colossus he wanted to kill. He wanted to get both for sure.
It's really just like these games, they're a lot about early game damage.
Yep.
You know, like if no early game damage is dealt by either, then I think Patience pretty happy to go up through three bases, kind of defend the whole time, because Fantasy does not want to seem to take it to the late base. He wants to play with a lot of bio, medivacs, use some drops and do damage. And I think Patience, he finally picked up on that. He finally picked up that he doesn't even need to cheese anymore. He can just play a little bit more standard, and somehow if he can stay alive and make it, you know, having enough Colossus to defend and gateway units to defend across three bases, he's going to be okay.
Fantasy just plays a very, very, very aggressive style, and he will just keep trying to make something happen. It reminds me a little bit of the Chinese ZVZ, you know, when Chinese Zergs go up against European Zergs, you just see them attack, 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 and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. And this is kind of how this goes for Fantasy, but the moment that one drop truly gets shut down, he has no backup plan. He never has that second starport. He never has, let's say a Ghost Academy with a bunch of ghosts or anything to fall back on. He doesn't even have...
He never has one Viking, Roddy.
And one Viking to kill the Prism. That's the only Viking he made. Either way, we are getting ready to hop into the final game of the second quarterfinals of the Intox 3 Masters Cologne. It's been
been a great series so far, and it's going to be played out on Moonlight Madness. On the right top side of Moonlight Madness, we're looking at the last Protoss in this tournament. Are we going to have one in the semifinals? It's Patience. All Protoss hope is resting on his shoulders right now, Todd.
You think he can? He's worried about it. He can feel it. Yeah. His Maybe. Opponent, standing on the bottom left-hand side of the map. He wants to win this badly, but now he's in a weird situation because he lost the last map playing as the Red Terran. It is Fantasy. Ayagos once said, if you need to make Ghost against Terran, you're already losing. Fantasy raised that and said, if you need to make Vikings against Protoss, you're probably already losing. What's next? Cass is going to show up and he's going to be like, if you need to play against Protoss, you're probably already losing.
I'm pretty sure that a couple of Terrans have tweeted that out already, Todd. It's just personal preference. There are a couple Terrans out there. For instance, Happy is often the opposite, right? Like, he loves making a lot of Vikings, loves making a lot of Ghosts, has always relied on that. I felt there was a time, you know, in Terran versus Protoss era where a lot of Terrans were quite okay with playing Ghost Viking because they just got extremely good at it, started scanning everywhere. But then the Protoss players, they stepped up their game as well, and they started getting cannons and pylons all over the map and not keep the high Templars together like a bunch of donkeys. And then basically anywhere Terran goes out on the map, super late game, there are pylons, there are cannons, and there are high Templars dropping storms left, right, bottom.
Yeah.
And that's when a lot of Terrans just gave up. They're like, okay, you know, this is just unbearable. Every single time I don't pay attention for 0.1 second, the storm lands on all my Vikings, those mechanical units, they don't, you know, regenerate, and I'm basically never able to fight. And everyone has their own approach still. A couple of Terrans still like to pull SCVs, some make a couple Ghosts, and then try to win. Fantasy goes for double factory, Drilling Claw, Widowmine, just goes all out with bio, no Vikings.
The last time that these two played, it was actually, they played Moonlight Madness as the first map. This time is the fifth one, and back then, Patience went for a Stargate opener, made a bunch of Phoenixes because he knew there was probably going to be some Widowmine drop. He defended very nicely at first, took a third base, but then got stretched apart against the drops of Fantasy and was forced into an attack, which eventually was defended. So Fantasy, last time that they met, he did win on that map, but that wasn't an easy win. And Patience, even though he had a good build order, eventually Fantasy was able to win. So both players, I feel like they might try to make a lot of corrections already. From the mistake that they made back then when they played each other.
I like that build from Patience on this map though, Todd. I'm not a big Stargate player myself because, like I said, you know, my Stargate units always fly into Widowmines. But if you look at the main base, as Funka's showing us a little bit right now, there's so much dead airspace around the main base of Patience. So every single time a medevac flies in, picks up some units, you can just send it in a corner. It can just idle there forever. If there's no Stargate out on the map, then Fancy, you know, he's going to have a great time. And on a certain point, he can fly in to three bases at once, and it's going to be very, very tricky to defend.
Absolutely. That Reaper is on a journey, by the way, Nick. Mm-hmm. Going all the way around, making sure there is no proxy anywhere on the map.
Did you say journey, Todd?
Yeah.
Don't stop believing. You know that song?
No.
You're just a small town boy. Oh, Todd, you need to work on your karaoke skills.
Yeah, well. You know my taste in music. I don't like all that stuff that you listen to.
Ah, you'd like Journey. You like a cheeky Journey song. So the Mothership Core flies across the map. Once again, by the way, Fantasy plays this super... four Marines is much worse. Be careful. But, you know, if he just rallies another Stalker across the map, is he doing that? There is something coming, right?
Yep.
I think this is so smart. I think Fantasy is going to be in a lot of trouble. Of course, this Reaper is going to be annoying.
Those Hellions and Marines are going to take forever to finally come out. The Stalker was attacking the SCV there instead of the Marines. Patience needed to correct that.
Oh,
he's going to get at least one of the
Reaper.
Marines.
That's so big, Todd. He doesn't have to worry about it anymore. He can just rally Stalkers across the map. And I really think Fantasy is in so much trouble right now. Is the game going to end here immediately? Maybe not, but he should be able to deal so much economic damage. This is absolutely phenomenal for Patience. Ends up losing a Stalker, perhaps a tiny bit sloppy, but this Mothership Core is still doing a lot of damage. These SCVs are not mining.
They have to be pulled, so that means they are not mining right now, and Fantasy is on the chase with two Stalkers there. More pressure is going to be applied, or does he go and defend? I don't think he should go and defend. He's corner boosting another Stalker there.
He's bringing a probe. Why not? Even if you only have a single gateway, just get another Stalker there.
He's actually getting another one behind this. Yeah. So even two Stalkers by two here might be enough to really do some more damage.
I like it. I like it a lot. He's like, kill those probes in the natural. I don't care. You're not going to get into the main base, mate. Pylon wall.
The floodgates are closed.
Fantasy has to, in my opinion, sacrifice his natural. I think he should give up on trying to defend this. Without a bunker on the low ground.
If he gets the Mothership Core, this is big. But the pylon here will complete, and now Warp Gate just finished. The gateways, they're ready to warp in, Roddy. Yeah, as soon as that pylon finishes.
Yeah, doesn't one really want to end up losing a stalker. There we go, two more stalkers being wiped in. One stalker does fall. Fantasy's doing a pretty damn good job so far. Patience has to make sure that bunker doesn't finish. You don't want that bunker on the low ground to finish, Patience. Your entire game plan right now relies on making sure there is no bunker on the low ground.
The Medivac's actually headed across the map here to try and get some probe kills. And since the Mothership Core and every single unit is across the map for Patience, it's going to be really hard for him to actually defend.
Yep, he's going to take a lot of damage at home, but he's doing a lot of damage on the other side of the map as well. This game is just madness right now, but
Patience,
this stock
actually,
account...
Is this a base trade? He's not defending at home.
Yeah, I'm not sure what he's going to do. Did he cancel one of those pylons? I think he's going to have to go home soon, actually, Todd.
What is happening?
Because the bunkers, I'm not sure if these bunkers...
Oh, he could have killed a Hellion with the probe. He was close enough.
I'm not sure if these bunkers are going to die.
Yeah, he's just going back home. He's giving up the aggression there. Going to warp in some stalkers back at home, finally get that Hellion.
Both players have done so much economic damage.
Yeah, but Fantasy's 28 STVs against 26 probes. This is fantastic here for him, already having that factory starport as well. He's going to start an eBay. He knows that Patience might be getting desperate, and he starts an eBay as Patience starts the Twilight Council.
Oh, and he's going to pick up these four Hellions. He's going to fly these four Hellions into the main base, and Patience has almost no units there. Todd. He has like one or two Stalkers. This could be an absolute probe massacre, and I thought it was looking very promising for Patience.
That's maybe bad that he starts that third command center because Patience still wants to be aggressive with the Stalkers.
But these Hellions in the main base, though, they're going to kill so freaking much. They might potentially kill everything. Patience sees it right now.
A few Stalkers there. They
line them up. Oh my god, 11 probes gone down already, and it's not even over yet. Photon Overcharge is not needed. No, it's not needed anymore because you've already lost 14 workers.
Do you think that the Stalkers across the map can do a lot? I think they can because they need starting a third CC there was very eager.
They need to do more than a lot, though. They pretty much need to win the game right now. If I'm Patience, I F2A because there's no transitioning from 16 probes.
He's got 16 probes against 36.
All right.
And now he's going to get right in there. Get the steam pipe. That's a good start, but now SCVs are going to be pulled.
Yep.
Fantasy knows that if he defends this, he's won the game.
Yep, but is he going to be able to defend it though? No stim makes it a little bit tricky. Marauder can die. You have to pick up those Marauders, Fantasy. You got to be extremely careful. Oh god, this is so close. I have absolutely no idea how this is going to go, but I actually think Patience...
Oh, if he scans for the Observer!
Oh my god, that mind shot did so much damage.
Yeah, that was massive. Another Stalker stuck on the left-hand side there. He's trying to regroup with that. And I think Patience, he has no plan into getting basically any other... kind of probes their economy. He needs to make only Stalkers try and finish the game right now.
Is he going
to
scan? Is he going to scan for the Observer? No, he doesn't scan in time. Patience could still win this because there is no Stimpak. There are almost no Marauders. And most importantly, Todd, there is no bunker over here.
Stimpak restarted, but the kiting is going to begin there. There is no time warp available. Not enough energy just yet for Patience. He's going to be kiting this.
I still think that Patience is winning this, Todd. I know he's down in supply. I know he has no probes, but how is Fantasy supposed to build up an army? Every single unit that pops is dying.
That third CC was, I think, a big mistake, and right now he's struggling to try and defend.
I almost feel like he has to try to kill the Observer, so there's no more high ground vision, so
there's
maybe...
two now, though.
Oh, well. I mean, I think a single scan, like, high ground vision is everything over here for Patience.
He has only three Marines.
Pick up the... Okay, he's microing the Medivac a little bit there. Good micro, of course. Good focus fire on both sides.
Widowmine... Kill the rocks. Oh, no.
Widowmine's gonna shoot at the Zealot and kill the SBs. Kills one of the Observers as well, but there's one more Observer left.
And there's actually a scan available here right now. If he has to kill that, Widowmine...
Kill the Observer, Fantasy. If you kill the Observer, then I think you can stabilize.
And behind his Patience actually restarted pro production. I think he's going to get the Dark Shrine. Yeah, there we go. He knows that the economy of Fantasy is being weakened, but I think Fantasy still has enough to get turrets, and he's getting the third orbital now. Hey. Fantasy taking a great option of the victory there.
Did he get both? Because I think there was another Observer flying there.
No, but the first one died already before from the Widowmine.
Yeah, I know, but then another one flew in. I think he just killed two Observers with a single scan. Oh my god. Yeah, because he has no more Observers on the map and two Observers and one more Observer was flying in. So with one scan, Fantasy kills two Observers there with a triple CC. Suddenly,
I don't think he gets the turrets.
Fantasy should have, Patience, in my opinion, should have never transitioned. He should have kept on trying, Todd. The moment you give Fantasy time to get 4, 5, 6 Marauders, this game is over, and this game will be over soon. Stimpak is finishing up. The Marauder count is too high. Patience has no money. Fantasy is on triple CC. That got so close. What a wild game 5.
Yeah, 24 probes to 38 SCVs here right now, and the Dark Shrine is going to finish in a second. There's still a pylon here on the right-hand side, and a turret is going... I really like the turret placement, to be honest. Instead of putting it in the middle line, kind of like in the middle of those buildings there, I guess SCVs will take longer to regen that and repair it, but regardless, in this game, Fantasy has got so much army. With 34 against 21, he's going to move across the map. We don't have a Photon Overcharge available yet. It's 91 energy here on that Mothership core.
Yeah, he will have Photon Overcharge soon, and the Dark Templars may do something, but it's triple CC, man. He can scan for days.
Getting followed.
He could actually just kill these Marines, by the way.
Fantasy across the map, starting to do some damage. Photon Overcharge was finally there and used.
And Immortals on the way. How much dark damage are these Dark Templars doing? Once again, triple Orbital Command Center. Plenty of scans should be available. Fantasy is losing a couple SCVs here and there, but Steam Bio is on the field. Combat Shield almost done as well, so it's actually going to be pretty damn strong. Colossus tech is nowhere in sight.
Yeah, he didn't even get Blink with this. Like, it's so funny to actually have this many Stalkers and not have Blink with them. It's so unusual.
I like the idea, though, because I felt, I mentioned this on Terraform, right? Like, if he would just get the second Stalker, I felt he could have done so much. And he was doing a lot, but Fancy being Fancy, just being such a good Terran, still making a lot of plays happen with these very few Hellions. I almost feel if Patience would have just straight up Tree-Gated, instead of getting a Robo and stuff as well, it would have been a lot better, because he would have been able to get more Stalkers quicker. But it got very close. I just don't think he should have ever backed off there in the end. Like, if you're all in, you're all in, man.
Yeah. Fantasy is a man of extremes, by the way. Like, he played against so many Colossi earlier and always made no Vikings. And now the one game that Patience is completely broke, and finally going for Robo Bay, we have a second Starport on the way.
That's pretty funny. Maybe he's worried that, you know, Patience makes a silly single Colossus or two Colossus, two base all in with a bunch of force fields. And
I think Fantasy just went into emergency mode. He's like, what can I lose to? He's like, yeah, DT is probably likely to get some turrets. No. What about Colossus transition? I don't want to lose again with a lot of bio on the ground, just losing everything. So gets a second Starport, and then that next fight is going to go for, I'm afraid it's going to be a total walkover, man.
I love that you say that, Todd, because I think that's very important. That's sometimes that a lot of people forget when you're playing StarCraft. If you're very far ahead, if you know you're very far ahead, just ask yourself the question, what can I still lose to? And like you said it, man, got the missile turrets against DTs. And now for the first time in this series, he's getting double Starport because he doesn't want to take a silly fight against a bunch of force fields and a Colossus, even when he has way more bio. So he's just getting these Vikings, even when he's not really a Viking player. Awesome game.
Oh my god, these observers. He actually dodged this one. That scan. Made it out of there. Patience. Makes his observer very nicely, but this army is so massive that even if there was, like, I feel like three Colossi, they might just crush through anyway with like some drop on top and a good attack. There is a few force fields available, though. But Patience, he's just in so much trouble. He's trying to get to Blink and Colossus tech. The first one is going to be out here in a moment. Fantasy, he's scanning all over the place. He sees the entire other side of the map there right now.
I mean, he could always... Oh, I like this. He's faking it. Oh, Fantasy with the place. Look at them. It's a magnet. He's going to chase these medevac. This is so cool, Todd. This is a ridiculously cool play by Fantasy. All of them are empty, Patience, but your natural is gone. You're going to end up losing that natural. That's so cool. GG is called. Fantasy wins the series. A very, very entertaining PvP series, and he's going to be the first Terran to advance to the Intact Extreme Masters semifinals.
It took him 5 games and to be 50 supply ahead and quite a few workers and army to finally do a successful drop and multi-pronged attack, Roddy. But he finally did it and closes out this series
in style, Todd.
A lot of people are going to be very happy here with this as Fantasy moves on to the semifinals to face Sue tomorrow. That's going to be insane.
This is one of the most perfect endings I think I've seen in a StarCraft 2 best of 5 for a long time. Like, whenever you set something up like that as a player and it works in game 5 of a best of 5, like, what more could you ask for, man? That's so cool. I love that stuff.
Poor Patience. When he saw those units at his natural, he must have been like, oh god.
It's so sad as well.
It's
because
time to leave.
Because his observer just saw the medevacs, and then he sees the medevacs flying, and he just didn't have the vision for those units on the ground. Because if he sees the units on the ground, then he won't fall for it. But sick play.
Yeah,
awesome.
Really, really good job here by Fantasy. And like I said, a lot of people are going to be very happy with this. Man, Terran getting a good bit of success there. And there's going to be more. Innovation against 4G later on, guaranteed Terran. And then Nurture against MMA also on next match coming up.
Yeah, that one is going to be super awesome. I can't wait for that one. But for now, I want to hear what Fantasy has to say about that pretty wild best of 5 that he just played against his teammate.
Thank you very much, Rotterdam and Todd, joined here by our second semi-finalist. Congratulations, Fantasy. Got to jump straight in there. What a crazy best of 5. That map number 5 in itself, What was he thinking playing it, during it? Was it as intense for everyone that was watching it? Did he think the game was slipping away from him? Was he in control of it?
자, 5경기를 일단 먼저 얘기를 하고 넘어가야 될 것 같은데 5경기가 참 왔다 갔다 장난이 아니었거든요. 정명 선수가 이제 직접 5경기에 대해서 설명을 좀 해주시죠.
초반에 그 피해를 입었을 때 아, 또 여기서 지현이한테 이렇게 지는구나 생각이 들었는데 맞고 나서 스캔을 뿌려보니까 생각보다 할 만한 거예요. 그래서 이거 할 만한가 했는데 끝까지 유불리는 잘 몰랐고 좀 정신없었던 게임인 것 같아요.
When the first draft came in, I was like, ah, God damn it, is the history repeating itself? And I thought it was already over. And then I'm like, okay, well, I have 50 mana on the orbital command, so let's sort of scan down, see what he's got. And I saw it, and it's like, wait a minute, I think there is a chance. So I tried to collect myself in during the game, and honestly, till the end, I had no idea if I was ahead or not. And it was the very last 30 seconds, I was like, oh, okay, whew, I got this.
I did have a couple of questions about the styles that Fantasy played here. The first one was about the Hellions. A lot of Hellions were, I think, the linchpin unit in the early game for the success there. Was this something that you thought Patience would be weak against, rather than committing more to Widow Mines? Just what were you feeling with the Hellion aggression? Did you have some sort of insight into how Patience would play?
자, 일단 요새 태프전에서 화염차를 그렇게 많이 보이는 경우가 그렇게 많지는 않은데 1경기에서 화염차 위주로 경기를 풀어 나가셨었거든요. 그때 조지현 선수랑 아무래도 팀 동료고 이러다 보니까 좀 더 이게 먹힐 거다 이런 생각이 들어서 1경기에 그렇게 화염차를 많이 쓰신 건가요?
네, 확실히 지연이라서 한계 있고요. 좀 생각보다 약간 시나리오대로 된 것 같아요. 그렇게 하면 피해를 줄 것 같았어요.
I use that build just because it was patience. Like we're all teammates, we know each other pretty well. So I'm like, maybe I should start off, try to throw him off a little bit in his pace. And I think it went out exactly how I imagined it to go.
All right, well, jump in here, one quick one pick. We always talk a little bit about how mind games, before a game, we always talk, okay, there's two teammates playing against each other. There's clearly going to be a lot of mind games in this series of because they just they know each other's games so well. Was that a part of his series as well today?
전반적으로 오늘 오전제를 하면서 팀 동료다 보니까 조지현 선수가 일단 판자기에 대해서 내가 지금까지 조지현 선수한테 얘기 안 했었던 상의하지 않았었던 이런 거 위주로 좀 풀어 나가야 되겠다 이런 생각을 많이 갖고 오전제를 시작을 하셨었나요?
근데 제가 지현이 오픈 브라켓 때 너무 얘기를 많이 해줬어요 테란 빌드에 대해서 그래가지고 뭘 쓸지 되게 고민을 많이 했는데 좀 생각대로는 잘 안 됐던 것 같고 그래서 오늘 스코어도 좀 힘들었던 것 같아요.
Overall, up until this point, when Patience was participating in the qualifiers and everything, I actually gave him a lot of feedbacks on how he should be tackling TBP. So coming into this matchup, I was actually completely drained out. I didn't know what I was going to be doing. So I was kind of going, match at a time. But overall, obviously, what I wanted to do is throw him off in the first set, see how it goes, and then think about the next map and the map after. And maybe because of that under preparation, if you could even call it, I think that's why the game was kind of a little bit lengthy, a little bit loose overall in all the best of fives.
Okay, that's a really illuminating answer there, of course. What I really wanted to ask about was something we've been seeing a lot of recently. It's Widow Mines dropping on top of the Stalker Colossus, right? It's this crazy move, and we sometimes see it, it just destroys the entire army, and sometimes it fails really hard. In a couple of the games, it didn't work very well. And I just wanted to hear Fantasy's thoughts on mainly that, first of all, the Cactus Valley game, when it didn't work out, did he feel like Patience was just too far ahead? Was his army too big? Could he have executed it better?
그리고 두 번째 Cactus Valley에서는 지뢰 위주로 많이 그런 플레이를 보여주셨는데, 일단 교정이 그렇게 좋지는 않았어요.
아, 그거요? 영어로 해야 돼요. In morning, I watched GSL Marus game, and it looks very funny. So It's my first without mind play, so it's not perfect, maybe.
Oh, okay, thank you. Thank you very much for that fantasy.
Of course, there was a few other times we did that. I was going to ask for more follow-up questions on that, but considering it was a bit of a spur-of-the-moment thing, not too much, I guess, technical analysis, going off that instinctive move, the game was almost kind of getting out of control there. I just wanted to ask about the mindset. After Cactus Valley, you know, things started to get out of control a little bit after a very strong start. Was there a point where he was very worried going into Game 5 about it slipping away?
I'm really able to say.
I wasn't too sure because he's like, oh, I get everything, and then he doesn't. Right. So let me translate this.
일단 첫 경기는 어떻게 보기엔 좀 압도적으로 좀 승리를 좀 따냈었던 것 같고 두 번째 경기에서도 유리했었던 거를 교전 실수를 하면서 좀 내줬었는데 그러면서 약간 멘탈이 좀 흔들리지 않았었나 경기 내적으로 그런 실수 잔실수라든지 이런 걸 많이 봤었거든요. 그래서 다섯 번째 이제 매치에 들어가면서 약간 좀 불안하다든지. 아 이러다가 진짜 또 지는 건 아닌가 이런 그런 걱정이나 그런 걸 어떻게 이제 리커버를 하면서 게임을 들어갔는지요?
일단 게임을 계속하면서 느낀 거는 지현이가 수비가 너무 좋은 거예요. 그래가지고 이거 다섯 번째까지 똑같이 하다간 똑같이 지겠다 싶어서 다섯 번째는 바이킹을 빨리 뽑아야겠다고 생각하고 게임했어요.
So it seems like there has been some sort of a pattern in Patience reaction, and that's why in the game five I was like, okay, this one is the one I'm gonna make Vikings and play the most standard as I can possibly be in the TVP, and I think that's how it worked out.
All right, thank you very much, James. Thank you very much, Pig. One final question then is a bit of English coming out there from Fantasy. There's obviously a lot of Brood War fans, a lot of StarCraft II fans that you have that are watching right now. Is there anything you can say to them in English for us before we go away?
Okay.
Don't mean to put you on the spot.
Okay. Always thank you, my fans. My next opponent is Su, very strong, but I'll do my best and
I will dominate.
Ladies and gentlemen, Fantasy, our second semi-finalist going through to play on Championship Sunday. We can check in with the bracket really fast here as we have two players through, but that means we have two best of fives remaining for today. As you can see on screen, Sue and Fantasy is the first semi-finalist for tomorrow, but next, it's Nurtio versus MMA, and later is the big one, 4GG versus Innovation. Make sure to check out all of the action that you've missed so far on plays.tv. We've got those first-person VODs up there, and of course, highlights from every single match that we've played so far. Before we go to a quick break, Roddy's been back in Cologne again.
I don't think my job sucks at all. I love my job.
Any problems a player has, they generally come to me first, whether it's at the event with their PC or if they've got problems with the hotel, their flights. Yeah, a babysitter is probably a bit demeaning to the players, but yeah, certainly I manage the players.
Yeah, apparently a technical issue with the computer, but I'm sure Graham is on it.
His hard drive wasn't in the computer. So I had to put the hard drive in first and then we were good.
I don't think there's a set, you know, the players who are more experienced are easiest to deal with or the other way around. I think it's very much on a player-by-player basis. There are certainly a few players who, when I look at their names and see, oh, they're attending my tournament, I know I'm gonna have to give them a bit of extra special attention and care just to make sure that they're happy and that I know that they're gonna be, you know, doing things on time and stick to my schedule. Yeah, certainly.
Yeah, everything looks good. Classic just needs like 5 minutes to warm up and then we should be starting. It's good.
Mouse wheel.
Yes. Driver?
Oh yes, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay.
Language barrier is certainly a problem, but I'd like to say that StarCraft is a sort of a universal language, and there are certain things that the players just understand. You know, if you say, you know, we start in 5 minutes, then they understand that. I'd say I have more problems dealing with an angry production than I do with angry players.
He's better in the second half. Oh, yeah. Broadcast on main stage.
I mean, you have to do Snoop TMI, yeah. But it's the same as not Snoop parting, but at the same time, Snoop parting is really good semifinals too, so.
Right, yeah. So that's fine. So let's just do Hero and whoever then on the main stage.
So Hero versus whoever. So, yeah, I mean you get foreigner or you get China, or you get local.
Yeah,
Chinese.
So either way it's fine. And it's Hero. Okay. We didn't get to see Hero too much today on main stage, only one match, so.
Well, we just drew the round of eight, which is here, and basically because of the limitations in the schedule, we could only show two quarterfinals tomorrow on the main stage. So I was just discussing with Will which matches he thinks would be the best to show on the main stage and which ones to have off stage.
The most stressful things in my job are, oddly enough, things that I can't control. So when the internet goes down, or when we have you know, a power outage, things that I can't control are stressful to me because I know that I can't do anything.
I am done for the day. We are all done for the day. Half an hour ahead of schedule. Perfect.